So we're glad that those who are here, you made it this morning. And maybe we'll have some more online watchers this morning in their pajamas. But we're glad you tuned in or you're getting here in person. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll worship together this morning. Dear God, we love you, God. We know that that no matter what time it is, that you are in control, God. You are sovereign. And Lord, we are thankful for that, Lord. And we just come this morning. A lot of us maybe have a lot of things on our minds. We're dealing with circumstances and things that we deal with in our life and our family. But we trust you, God. We come this morning to give those things over to you. And we say, Lord, that we give those to you, and we trust you and your wisdom. Lord, now as we come to worship, Lord, I pray that we'll just sit at the foot of the cross, we'll sit at the foot of the throne, and we will worship you and you alone. We're not here to have an emotional experience. We're not here to, get a feeling, but we want to worship you because you are worthy, God. Lord, I thank you for those that are here, and we just give you glory and praise and honor. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, all God's people said.
Amen. attention that when I give some of my little notations up here that I tend to favor cats. So, in order to be fair, today I'm going to share a little bit about dogs. 100,000. That is the amount 100,000 times better that dogs smell than humans smell. 100,000 times. Now, a dog's nose is an incredible instrument. All of you have seen dogs tracking or sniffing, things like that. A couple of things about it. A dog can breathe in, it can inhale and exhale at the same time. Unlike us, we breathe in and breathe out. They can do both at the same time. They also smell and breathe. They have little extra slits in the sides of their noses that are offset slightly. So a dog can literally hone in a three dimension to go exactly to an odor. Whereas we can smell like coffee brewing out with the what we have smelled the coffee pot. We know that it's out in the lobby, kind of a general area. We could go out there, but we use our eyes and our logic to say, oh, it's a coffee pot that's sending out the smell. But we don't know exactly where it's at by our nose. We use other factors. A dog would hone in right on the coffee pot. They also smell the passage of time. What that means is that they can smell the decay difference between an odor. For example, if you see a dog tracking a scent, like blood scent or cloth, looking for a missing person. And so how would they know which direction to go, left or right, when they come across a scent? They can literally discern the time that has passed between when an object has gone out that way. So, if a person's walked from this side to this side, the scent is going to be stronger on the right than it is on the left, and a dog can pick that up. And then lastly, there are 220 million scent receptors in a dog's nose. 229. That's a lot of receptors. And the reason I bring that up is Professor Brown was saying last week, the evidence that we see in creation, what God has created for us. And you think about how magnificent just a dog's nose is. Just the nose. Not the rest of the animal, just the nose. It's an incredible thing. And then the rest of creation is just as magnificent. But think about a dog has 220 million receptors to scent, to detect scent. How many receptors do we have to detect our Creator in heaven? And that's what I think we can take from that. That God has created so many different ways for us, all of our senses, sight, touch, smell, hearing, taste, to experience His creation in so many different ways. If we just take a moment to, as we sang a minute ago, to worship Him every day, to look for that creation. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for such a magnificent creation that You put all around us, Father. You've given us so many different ways to experience it. We just so often we let ourselves become so busy, so distracted, so focused on the other things instead of focusing upon You, Father. When we seek You and look in Your will, Father, we just experience all of the beauty that's around us, all of the encouragement, all of the blessings, such beauty that You've given us, Father. So, Father, I ask that You be with us today and this week as we go forth, that we take just a moment to pause to remember that You created so many different ways for a dog to smell. How many different ways do You create for us to live through You? So let us find but just a single one and focus on it this week, Father. And focus on the blessings that You've given us, especially the blessing of the salvation of Your Son, the gift of His sacrifice so that we can have a relationship with You, Father. We ask that You be with Pastor John and Jesus' this message this morning. We pray all these things in the name of Your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. All right. Thank you, Rob. If you're visiting with us today, I want to say thanks for being here and just joining us in person or online. This time we kind of would greet one another in the Lord. If you're visiting with us, if you would just do us a favor and let tear out section of the bulletin, just fill that out. And just, we want that as a record that you attended with us today. I promise we won't send the SWAT team to your house and invade it, but we just want to have that record. That's your gift to us today. And but this time, we'll just take that time to greet one another and kick shin, fist bump, whatever appropriate. I do give you permission then because of the time change. If you see somebody fall asleep, you can stand up, walk around, slap them in the back of the head. No. let's greet each other and then we'll have a joint.
I don't know. Yeah. Make sure you get like a certain. Bobby, if he's got sports up there, he's got to talk about the Georgia Tech.
And
the ACC.
Look it up, and the last year's statistics, does anybody have a guess who the wealthiest
top 10.
Cristiano Ronaldo.
Close, but not top.
Tiger Woods?
No. Not even in the section. The number one athlete in the world last year that made $106.2 million was Roger Federer. You don't know who he is.
Oh, yeah.
Not tennis ball, he's a tennis player. But then second was, who said Messi? Really? He's number one now, apparently. Lionel, who will be directed in soccer, is the wealthiest athlete in the world now. And let's see, the second last year. Third was Ronaldo, another soccer player. Fourth was another soccer player, Neymar. So no one's in our sports in America or the biggest in the world, they're not even close. Soccer is the largest and most popular sport in the world. Mm-hmm. But it is reality. Boy, you guys are for sure. Number five, the closest in an American sport was LeBron James, number five. Yeah. He's a basketball player. And then number six was Steph Curry. But a lot of those guys are making a lot of money in the sport, but they also make tons of money in endorsements. But that's what that is their way. That is what somebody's paying them for what they do. And each of us that works in here, if you have a job, or somebody may have retired from working, we work, like the job I have right now, I work 2 weeks and I get paid. I get paid every other week, right? 2 weeks later. And each of us has different jobs. I don't know if there's any professional athletes in here making anywhere close to what any of these guys are making. And you can argue with them. But if someone's willing to pay them, not to argue with them. Right. People that pay them are making a lot more money than they are. So, hey, you know. But it's their way. It's what they do for their job and for them. It's what they've earned. And it makes me think about what I've earned and the wage of my sin. And the Bible tells me is that. And really, the one who paid that, ultimately, was Jesus. He paid the price for my sin debt. Every one of us has sin in our lives. There's no one in here. Remember 2 weeks ago I said, all of our sin comes short of the glory of God. All means everybody. Everybody in all nations, all races, all creeds, every language in the world is a sin, no matter where you came from. Including the eyes of God, Jew and Gentile. Sin, right? Separates us from God. And our punishment, our wage from that is that every one of us has a time appointed to die. And that can be difficult. And they're like, man, that's just like, hey, you're trying to bring us down this morning. No, that's reality. We all have 100% chance of it. Can't escape it, right? No matter when that is. But the second half of that verse is the great, great news for all of us. That the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's what Jesus came to the world for. All those sinners we talked about a couple weeks ago. All the sins come short of the glory of God. And when we fall, when we fail, last week, when we talked about, boys and girls, temptation. And I gave you the story of the farmer and the snake. And we're all tempted and we all fall at times. Depending on what temptation we fall into. God can help us with that temptation. He desires to and wants to. We talked about in 1 Corinthians 10, 13. We'll provide a way out. He's faithful. But the wage of our sin that separates us from the Holy God is dead. But the gift of God that we have is eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Lord, that can bring us back, that can redeem us through the cross of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He paid that for us, for every one of us. No matter who you are, no matter how bad you think you are, boys and girls, I don't think of boys and girls sometimes as doing awful things. I think of some of us adults that have done some awful things in our lives that we would think separates us from God, no matter what that is, whatever label we want. But sometimes we think in our lives we've done something so horrible that God can never want us and never love us. That's just simply not true. There's nothing that we can do. See, God loves every person. Brought to my mind this morning as we were praying about that God loves from the very unborn child to the condemned on death row. Every life is precious from the very youngest to the very oldest. And God loves us. And he gave his son Jesus for us to pay for our sin debt. So it doesn't matter. You don't have to be Messi. You don't have to be Federer. You don't have to be LeBron, Steph Curry, Mike Trout. You don't have to be these guys. Jesus doesn't care. The money doesn't get you anywhere. It doesn't get you to heaven. Can't take it with you. What gets you to heaven is the cross of Jesus. Jesus himself died on that cross to pay for mine and your sin.
Amen.
Father God, Jesus, I don't deserve you, but I'm thankful that you came into the world to die for my sins, for our sins, for the sins of the world. And that while we do experience a physical death, we don't have to experience spiritual death and separation from you for eternity. But we can experience eternal life with you because of what you did for us, Jesus. Not because we deserve it, but because of your grace that you offer to everyone freely and willing to accept the gift of salvation. Jesus was the greatest gift we could ever have by far. There's no money that we could ever have. There's no material thing that we could ever have that comes close to comparing with salvation. Lord, thank you for paying that for me and for us. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
Everything in life happens for a reason.
And God has a plan. Not having a relationship with my dad and him pushing me down has always brought me to a negative place. But this poem has shown me that God is my true father. 2 Corinthians 6:18, and I will be your father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty.
Bless the Lord.
Oh, know a lot of people that minister to them. I know that they need to hear that, and I know that the people in the church need to hear that as well, that probably watching online today. So thank you for sharing that.
Yes.
This is an awesome song, too. Yes. All right. Well, like I said, I start seeing you guys fall asleep. Let's go behind the mic and stop in the
background.
If you need to stand up, get that platform, that's okay. I'll just thank you for praising the Lord or something.
Amen.
We'll do that.
Amen.
So, I know it's rough. That time change is mean stuff. I mean, who thought about that? All right. Real quick, before I get into the sermon this morning, I do want to mention that next Tuesday, we are doing that food box giveaway with Gwinnett County. It'll be starting at 4 o'clock. If you're going to volunteer, and you're going to like, well, how about that? If you could be here at 3 or 3:30 to kind of get things going, that would be awesome. I completely understand that if you're working, you can't get off work, that's no problem. But if you can't be here, if you want to be here on 3 through 30, we'll start prepping and doing some things then. Next Sunday morning, right after the service, I want to just briefly meet with everybody who's going to be able to help out just for 5 minutes down front. We'll just kind of give some basic instructions, give you some more details like that. So if you're planning on volunteering next Tuesday, the 23rd, for the food box giveaway, just plan on staying about 5 minutes after the service. We'll just kind of discuss a few things, make sure everybody knows what's going to happen. And that would be that. So, all right, I'm looking forward to what the Lord's going to do and how He's going to use this to help our community out. So, all right, well, let's get into the sermon here. Last week we started a new series called Known, and you know, it's all about how God reveals Himself to us. We started looking at some questions. And if you're familiar with these questions, I'll have Ashley put them on there. We talked about these different ones. You know, people start out with, does God exist? And then we go from there all the way to the top, like, well, okay, how can you Christians, how do you know that God exists? How can you boldly claim that? You know, and we talked about the different steps in between there. Last week we looked at how God reveals Himself through creation and through our conscience, that outwardly in creation and inwardly in our conscience there. And so we looked at, the first step there, which God is the right God. We can see that creation shows us that there is a creator, and that design shows us that there's a designer in all those different areas. And that can lead us so far, you know, that we can make some basic assumptions about who God is. He's powerful, that He's personal, that He's intelligent, because He designed things. And so we can get somewhat of a pretty good basic description of what God is like. Well, today we're going to kind of finish. You see, my drawing skills are not that good, so I need a graphic design. Anyway, but you know, we're building this foundation, or this building, so to speak, there. And you know, last week we did creation concepts. Today we're going to look at, okay, how else has God revealed Himself to us? There, we talked about what we call general revelation last week, and then this week we're going to look at something we call special revelation, or sometimes it's called specific revelation, and how God reveals Himself to us in specific ways, in special ways. So go ahead and go to the next slide, Ashlyn. Sorry there. Just kind of as a reminder, general revelation last week was knowledge about God given to all people. That's the key point, that all people, for the purpose of making known that God exists, that He exists. Everyone sees creation. Everyone has a conscience that they recognize good and evil from. We see something, we say, that's evil. You know, that act of injustice or 9/11 or whatever that was. That is given to everybody. So today we're looking at special revelation. This is a little bit different. Here's kind of a basic definition. What exactly is special? Well, special revelation is just kind of a basic definition. It says something like this. People can learn about God's character. I know there's a lot of blanks here, so I'll get you going. People can learn about God's character, His will, His purpose for creation, and His plan of redemption, because God has revealed Himself in this way that we can know Him. So I'll say that one more time. his will, what he desires, what he wants, his purpose for creation, what's all this for, what is all about, his plan of redemption, because God revealed himself this way. And because of that, we can know him. So there, we come in as believers, as followers of Christ, and say, yes, we can know that God exists through various ways, but we can also know God in a personal way, and we can know what he's like, and what his will is, and what his desire is. And we're going to look at the two different ways that God reveals himself, specifically, or through special revelation. Number one in your outline is God specifically revealed himself through the written word. If you go with me to 2 Peter chapter 1, we'll kind of start off on this passage, and then we'll kind of branch off into some other places, but these few verses in 2 Peter chapter 1 really kind of describe everything that we're going to be talking about today. So I think it's a great passage to look at and see both of the ways that God specifically revealed himself to us. Let me start verse 12 here. So I always remind you of these things, even though you know them and are firmly established in the truth that you now have. I think it is right to refresh your memory as long as I live in this tent, this body, because I know that I will soon put it aside, as our Lord Jesus Christ has made it clear to me, and I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. So here's Peter. God had revealed to him, he said, hey, my time on earth is about done. It's about over. God has revealed to me that my time's going to be end. He felt like the persecution that was after him was coming to a place where he could no longer continue and would be caught. And we know that eventually the tradition says that he was crucified upside down, because he didn't want to be crucified like the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's writing to them. He's giving them a farewell thing here. And then he goes on here in verse 16. He says, "For we did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, 'This is my Son, whom I love and whom I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice and came from heaven when we were with him on that sacred mountain. And we have the word for the prophets made more certain, and you do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in the dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." So just in these few verses right here, we see two specific ways that God revealed himself. Through, number one, the written word, and then number two, we'll get to in just a minute, the living word. So I want us to look at the written word first. And we see from this passage here, especially verse 20, 21, is where it really talks about the scripture here, that God used people to speak and also to record the words of Scripture. It was through man from God. If you kind of want to put it together, it was a combination effort. It was from God through man. That was the thing. Look at verse 20. It says that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation. That God used men to speak these words back in the Old Testament, and then it was eventually recorded, written down, and God used men, again, to record the words of the Lord and write that down. So that's what we see there. Now, I just want to address real quick one objection. You may say, wait a minute, Pastor John, how could sinful man, imperfect man that has an evil heart and corrupt, how could they correctly record the words of God and not mess it up? We have all these mistakes all the time, and people are imperfect, and you may be wondering that yourself, or maybe you have a friend that wonders that. Let me just give you a thought here, and then we can go a little bit more into detail next week, okay? But just a simple little phrase here. God can use a crooked stick to draw a straight line.
Amen. Amen.
Right?
That's right.
You
know, amen.
You ever gotten bored, maybe, and you're taking a paper clip and try to straighten one of those out, make it like perfectly straight? It's almost impossible, right? Unless you get like a bunch of pliers and, you know, whatever. But, you know, as much as we try to follow Christ and in our human ability, we're imperfect people. But it's God's supernatural ability to use us to inspire the writers of the Old Testament. Now, we'll talk about this a little bit next week when we get into inspiration and inerrancy. We'll get into this a little bit more in detail. But it is possible for an all-powerful supernatural God to use imperfect men to draw that straight line, if you will, so to speak. And so that's just a thought I'll leave you with, and we'll come back to that next week and get that a little bit more in detail, spend some more time with that. But verse 21 there, it says, therefore, prophecy never had its origin in the will of man. It's not from man. You know, by the way, if somebody ever says that to you, I don't believe anything written by man. You know, one would say, everything is written by man. So you believe anything? You know, that's when you kind of turn that on itself. You know, if somebody struggles with that, then everything we have is written by man. So where do you go? You don't even believe that? So just one extra thought there. But it says, the prophecy never had its origin in the will of man. You know, man is the vessel that God uses. We're going to see here, verse 21, that it is a Holy Spirit guided process. That's what the scripture says here, verse 20-21. It says that they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one who influenced them. You know, there's all these different, there's four or five different interpretations. I remember going through seminary in my basic classes, and there's four or five different thoughts. Well, was it a dictation note, or was it, you know, if you want to have that discussion with me, we can do that sometime during the week, and we can talk about the different ways that perhaps God inspired these people to do that, but not here. Okay, we'll just leave that, but there's a lot of good stuff in that. But this Holy Spirit guided this process. He used people to record, to write down the words of the Lord and to give it to us, to explain it. The Bible is very complex, isn't it? I mean, some people can sit down and read a novel, you know, in a week or two or a couple days. But when it comes to, like, reading the Word of God, it's a struggle. Why is that? Well, I think one of the reasons why is because it contains so much truth and so much to process and so much power. You know, Timothy says that it's, you know, alive and active. It affects us when we read it. We just can't read it like a novel. It's different. And I fully understand that there are difficulties in the Bible. You know, there many people have pointed out things to me. Well, the Bible talks about slavery and repressive women. And they'll name different things, stuff like that. And, you know, there's Old Testament, the annihilation passages, and the Canaanites. And there are real struggles that we have to deal with and things that we have to understand. But here's the thing with that. We have to understand that the Bible is not written to us, but it was written for us. And we have to remember that the Bible was recorded for a whole other generation and culture 2,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago. And we come to it today in our civilized, you know, we read stuff there. I don't understand that. What does that say? And we don't look at it in the context in which it was written. And that will be your first problem. If you go to the Bible and you read stuff and you don't understand the context in which it was written in, you're going to have some problems. So that's why it is our part to go and to dig and to look at the culture, look at the historical context. That's so important. An apologist I know named Greg Kokel, he explains it like this. He said, think about the Bible as kind of a union rules book. You know, unions come about because workers aren't being treated right, or, you know, that they stick up for the workers. Maybe some of you are a part of a union at your job or something like that. And so these unions are formed to kind of make sure that people are taken care of. Well, that's what much of the Old Testament is written kind of like. When sinful man started doing certain things that God never intended, God kind of came in and said, okay, we need to have some laws here. We need to talk about divorce. We need to talk about how you treat a slave and how this happens. And so that's where most of these laws from the Old Testament come from. And if you look at the laws of the Old Testament compared to anything of the other ancient writings like the Code of Hammurabi and all these other things, the moral character is like so far above what human people were willing to do and stuff. So that's kind of how we need to see that. If that example kind of helps you out a little bit there, I hope that does. One thing I want to recommend a resource to you. This is, if you're saying, okay, how do I interpret the Bible? How do I read it correctly? This is the best book I think you can buy for beginners. This is called How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth. It's by two authors, Gordon Fee and Douglas Stewart. It's an easy read. It will take you through all the different genres of the Bible and how you should look at them. It'll give you examples of that. And I thought about this week. If you're a Bible study teacher and you would like a copy of this book, you just text me or come to me and tell me, Pastor John, I like that. Because I believe if you read this book as a Bible study teacher or an assistant teacher, it will help you in your teaching your class. And I would gladly gift you a book. So if that would be something you would like, if you want to buy it yourself, that's fine. But I would be glad to gift you this book because I believe it's that valuable. It's called How to Read Your Bible for All It's Worth. It's just a basic understanding of how you can read through the Bible, and it helps you see that different context and really understand that. That's just a great place to start. It's a solid piece of literature that many people have used and can explain. So I just recommend it to you. If you're a teacher or anybody, you don't have to be a teacher. You can just want to know more about the Word of God and say, I want to dig in. So I just want to recommend that to you. So quickly, let's go to, and there's, I made a mistake here. In your bulletin, it might say Titus 2:13. That's my fault. I told Stacy I gave her the wrong scripture this week, but it's 1 Thessalonians. I got my teams wrong. It's 1 Thessalonians 2:13. So scratch that out in your outline. But if you want to go to 1 Thessalonians 2:13 with me, I saw some of you shaking your heads like, yeah, I looked that up. That was the one. We're eating too much. All right, here. Let's read this. It says, and this is Paul writing to the church there in Thessalonica. He says, and we also thank God continually because when you receive the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but actually as it is the word of God, which is at work in you who believe. So here's an example in the New Testament where Paul is bringing the gospel on his mission trips, and so he's calling it the word of God here. You see that? We're looking at this next week. I'm going to show you where Paul and Peter even point to each other in the New Testament and say, hey, what they're saying is scripture. What they're saying is the word of God. They recognize not only the Old Testament, but also the New Testament as the word of God. And here Paul just kind of makes a reference to it in 1 Thessalonians. So it's not the word of men, like Paul said here, but actually as it is, the word of God. And we'll talk about this next week as we go into detail there. All right, number two, my guideline, the second way that God reveals himself to us is through the living word. Now, to help you kind of, okay, the living word is talking about Jesus Christ here. To help you understand who is Jesus and what does he teach, what does he say, I just want to help you with this little, I guess, I don't know if it's a mnemonic device or whatever you want to call it, an acronym, whatever. But if you just remember GCH and then the number one, okay? Remember the ones. If you want to know who Jesus is, just remember these three letters and go to these passages in these three books of the Bible. All right? They're all in chapter one of each of these three books. And they tell us a lot about who Jesus is. They show us who he is, what he taught about himself, and not only about God there, but so we're looking at these three things. So the first one is John chapter 1, and you're probably familiar with this. Let me turn in my cylinder. If you've been on our mission trips, you know this is one of the verses that we use all the time. But John chapter 1, 1 through 14, I'm just going to read the first five verses here, and I'm going to skip down to verse 14. It says, in the the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness is not understood. And then if you go all the way down to verse 14, we cannot understand, what's this Word, capital W, in the first chapter of John here? What is this talking about? Well, verse 14 says that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory and the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So that Word, capital W there, is just a poetic way to describe Jesus Christ. He is the living Word. That word in Greek, logos, is the word that is used to describe the living Word. So what do we learn here in John chapter 1? Well, the very first verse is that the Word was with God and the Word was God. Now, in my peon of a brain here, the only way that verse makes sense, that someone is with God and is God, is that it's the Trinity. Right? And my Jehovah's Witness brothers will freak out and like, I don't understand that. But according to, and I guess I should call them brothers because I don't believe this. That's the same God. But the Word is with God and the Word was God. That only makes sense in the view of the Trinity. And the Trinity is a complex thing to understand, but I will just tell you, that's what the Bible describes. It's one what and three who's. That's what the Bible teaches about the Trinity there. So we learn that Jesus is God and Jesus is with God. And then verse 3, it says that the Word created everything. So Jesus is creator. He had just as much part of creation as the Father did. And then verse 14 says that the Word, that Jesus, dwelt among us. I mean, that's what we call his incarnation. He came to earth. God, you know, the best way that he revealed himself to us was in the flesh, in person. And we're going to see what that entails here in just a minute. So that's J, that's John. The next letter there on your little an acronym is C. That's for Colossians chapter 1. So flip over, if you will, go to Colossians chapter 1. And we're going to learn a little bit more about who Jesus is. Way ahead of me, or you fall asleep on every page that's turned in. All right, Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20 says this. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Listen to verse 19 and 20 here. And he is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. So here in Colossians, we learn a lot about who Jesus is. Verse 15 says that he is the image of the invisible God. That image in Greek, the imago, is talking about like an image on a coin, something that represents what, you know, a lot of times in the Roman times, they would put the emperors or put their own face on that coin when they were in power. And that represented them. So he is the image of the invisible God. Verse 16 again describes him as creator. It says that for by him all things were created. And then later on it says that by him and for him. So it even talks about that creation was created for his purpose. For his purpose. Then if you go down to verse 19 and 20, this is where I think it's important. It says that God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. The fullness of God dwelled within Jesus. So Jesus is not just like vice president. He is fully God as much as the Father is God. And the Holy Spirit is God. He is fully God. You know, now Jesus did limit his powers and use his abilities verse 20 also says that he was our reconciler. It says that he redeemed us through his blood shed on the cross. So we see a little bit of this purpose there. What did God want? Well, he wanted to reconcile us. He wanted to bring us back, to redeem us into a right relationship with him that was marked by sin. And now, if you'll go with me to the last passage here, Hebrews chapter 1. This is my favorite. I love this. Ralph read it Wednesday night when he was leading prayer meeting. But I love these first four verses. Hebrews 1:1-4. It's just, man, it's so great. And it again tells us who exactly Jesus is here. It says, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers, though through the prophets and at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven, and so became as much superior to the angels as the name that he inherited is superior to theirs. So here we learn that the author says that God communicated in the past through the prophets and through other various ways there. He says, but in these last days, God has spoken to us through his Son. That is the way he's done it, through Jesus Christ. And so we see here that again, Jesus is labeled, called creator. He's part of that. Not only that, but he's also a sustainer. He creates things. But according to verse 3, it says he sustains everything by the powerfulness of his word. He holds it all together. You ever think about that? That everything was brought together with creation, and that's powerful. But at the same time, God holds it together by his word, by his will, that he desires it to stay. And one day that may change. I don't know. But then also there, the last two, he says that he is the exact representation of his being. Again, you get another example. Now, wait a minute. You say, well, hang on. Who says this? Well, we don't know who the author of Hebrews is, but we know John and Colossians were. But these were his followers. These were people that spent time with Jesus. They heard his teachings. These are the things that they drew from spending a number of years with him. These are the things that Jesus taught. And now they're fleshing them out. They're writing them out. And so, if you're going to trust anybody, you're going to trust the people that knew him best. Some of you might say, wait a minute. Don't you see what you're doing, Pastor John? You're talking about Jesus in the Bible. That you're saying that the Bible is the way that God revealed himself, so it's kind of like you're cheating a little bit, Pastor John. Well, not really. You can count on two hands the number of people who were actually bona fide biblical New Testament scholars and atheists, skeptics alike, you can probably count less than 10 actual people that actually believe that Jesus never existed. And I'm talking about, you always find the crazy people online, I understand that. Jesus, he was a legend. Yeah, but I'm talking about bona fide scholars, people that study and that know history and know that. You can find probably less than 10 people that believe that Jesus never existed. 97% of all New Testament scholars, and I'm saying people like Parker, who's like the strongest atheist and New Testament scholar out there, he doesn't believe the Bible. But he says Jesus existed. They say that. And then you say, well, if you're using the Bible, that's not fair. You can't do that. Well, what if I told you there are 19 other sources outside the Bible that refer to Jesus and the Christians? There are sources of people that make fun of Jesus for his claim of being born of a virgin. There are 19 others. That's only 19. Only 19? Well, that's, think about how long it is. We have less than that when it comes to like copies of Homer and some of these others. So that's a lot. So that there is great evidence that Jesus existed. And like I said, that's just something, again, if that struggle's there for you, I understand that. Let's go to lunch. Let's have a talk. Let's dig into that a little bit later. Maybe on some other time. But there's great evidence there. I just want to take the last 5 minutes to kind of address something that I threw up to you last week. We started kind of asking a bunch of these questions, and I kind of laid a little bit of a, I guess we'd call it a hook with you last week. We talked about How is it possible? Can someone who only sees general revelation, because remember from last week, general revelation is seen by everyone. Everyone sees creation. Everyone has a conscience. We know good and evil. We recognize that. I threw this question out. Is it possible for someone who only, or who has seen creation conscience, is it possible for them to go to heaven with or without knowing who Jesus was? That question may come up at your work, or may come up amongst friends. What about the people who've never heard of Jesus? Do they go to heaven? What kind of God would do that? You know, we know the scripture. We know that the Bible's pretty clear that, you know, John 14:6, that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So how do we handle that? What kind of thing? I realize I'm giving you a 5-minute answer that probably needs about 3 hours. But again, let's have a conversation. If this is something that you want to know more about, call me up, text me. Let's go to lunch and sit down. Let's talk about this. But let me give you a couple of thoughts here. On the bulletin there, you see some scriptures and some different points. I want to point you to those, but I'm going to go, if you will, just to Romans chapter 10, because I think this is a key verse when it comes to talking about this issue. What about somebody who's never heard of Jesus? Do they go to heaven? You know, so let's look at some things here. Let me give you some thoughts here. Starting in verse 12, Romans chapter 10, verse 12. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they've been sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. But not all the Israelites accepted the good news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? Consequently, faith comes by hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. But I ask you, did they not hear? Of course they did. Their voices went out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. And again I ask, did Israel not understand? First Moses says, I will make you envious by those who were not a nation, and I will make you angry by a nation that has no understanding. And Isaiah boldly says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, all day long I've held up my hand to a disobedient and obstinate people. There's a lot in there. I just want to encourage you to kind of go back maybe after today and read through that. But this passage kind of seems to suggest a couple different things. Number one, that it was already mentioned there, the quote from Psalm 19, or verse 18 in Romans 10 there. He says, their voice has gone out to the earth, and their words to the world. That's a quote from Psalm 19, which we talked about last week. The creation shows that. So this passage here and some other that we look at here really kind of shows us that the voices that point to the Lord are leading something that for people who look and respond for God and say, okay, God, you've revealed something about yourself, but I want to know more. So there's a little bit more to this here. We see some of these passages here. You know, he says there, I was found for those who did not seek me. Some people look for the Lord, and they find him. But also, there are people who the Lord just kind of comes up and whacks them in the back of the head and says, hey, I'm here. Think about Paul, right? He was zealous for persecuting the Christians. He was doing his own thing, and the Lord found him and came to him and used him. It was kind of one of those unexpected type things where he appeared to him. You know. And then I'll look at the example of Acts chapter 10 with Cornelius. Think about, you know, the scriptures there describe Cornelius as a God-fearing man. That was someone who believed in God, but they weren't fully, you know, someone who had believed over like the Jews and all that. And what did God do? He called Peter, right? He said, Peter, I want you to go to the house of this centurion, and I want you to share the gospel with Peter. What? You know, but God sent him to Cornelius, and that's when Cornelius gave his life to the Lord. I see that in Scripture in multiple places. The passage that you see in Revelation 14 talks about an angel that was sent throughout the earth to share the gospel with people. That's without human interaction there. Even Acts 13 says that the gospel is spread throughout the ends of the earth right there in Acts 13:47. Sometimes for us to say, wait a minute, how does someone come to Jesus that they never heard Jesus? Well, I'm not the smartest person, but I'm fully aware that God can do things in pretty amazing ways, and he can send people and angels to places that we have no clue. I've heard someone who was a missionary before tell me that they had gone on a mission trip to a place that they knew that had never been reached before, and people had heard about a Savior who died for someone's sins. They didn't call him Jesus, but I forget the word he used several years ago, but there are testimonies like that of missionaries who go overseas, and they come across these people groups, and they come ready to share the gospel, and these people groups are ready, that God reveals to these people who have not had a touch from the Scriptures or through a missionary about Jesus Christ, that they were already prepped and ready through God's revelation, and he's kind of showed them through dreams or visions about who he was. I'm not smart enough to figure out, well, how does that all play out? I don't fully understand that, but I just know what Scripture teaches. That if people are looking for light, if they're seeking truth, God will give them more light. He will show them, okay, you're honestly seeing where did this come from? Let me show you who the Creator is. And he reveals to them. And, you know, who are we to say, well, we haven't gotten everywhere? Well, think about when Jesus came in the time of the Roman world. It was the central nation that spread out around the rest of the world, all throughout different areas. You know, it was just that time. The Roman world was known for a lot of different things. They created roads and systems and organization. And that's exactly when Jesus came and his disciples were after that. And who are we to say that the word didn't get out to the rest of the world? We have people in our community that are from all over the world that know who Jesus Christ is. And because the gospel has been spread to them. And sometimes it's so easy for us to make a judgment. Well, I don't know. How do you know that? Well, I just know what the Scripture says. And that's what I trust. And so I just want to encourage you there. So just kind of leaving you as we wrap up here. Next week, we're going to come back. We're going to take a deeper dive into the Bible. We're going to look at how do we know that the Bible is actually inspired and that it is inerrant? How can we boldly say, well, you believe the Bible is inerrant? We're going to look at that next week, so I want to invite you to come back next week. Ashley, yeah, thank you. We're kind of building our house, right? You know, if we're making that argument at the top that we can say that we know God and who he is, what he's like, I believe that this is good stuff right here. We see God in creation. We know him through the conscience. And we also see that he revealed himself through his word and through his son. And that builds a strong case. We will come back on Easter and talk about a little bit more about Jesus and who he is and what the claims he made. Is he just a good teacher or is he more? We'll look at that next week. But you know, again, I realize that this is very kind of a heady sermon for a lot of us. There's not a lot of application or practicality to it. But I just have two questions for you today. Do you know God? Do you have a relationship with him personally? You know, we just read Romans 10:13. It says that for everyone who calls on the Lord shall be saved. God is there. He exists. He lets us know that. But it's our choice whether we want to call him or not. You know, it's not about just knowing things. You know, it's not about having knowledge in your head, but it's trusting in your heart. It's like the example of the guy who went over the Niagara Falls in the wheelbarrow several decades ago. You know, people would come and watch him go back and forth on this tightrope. And he said, do you believe I can do it? And I said, oh yeah, he would carry all these different things in this wheelbarrow. He put bricks and all these pretty things, and he'd ask people, do you think I can go across with this? And they're like, oh yes, we do. And he said, do you believe so much that you would get in the wheelbarrow and go with me? Okay, well, I don't know about that. You know, But that's what we have to do when it comes to Christ. Yes, you may understand that Jesus loves you, that Jesus died on the cross for you, but there's going to be a point in your life from the scripture that you come to trust him with your life for yourself and say, I want to live for you. I want you to be my Savior. And so if you've not done that this morning, I want to invite you to do that. You can do that through a simple prayer. It's not the words of prayer that mean anything, but it's your heart. If you want Christ to come to your life, if you want to receive him as Lord, make him Savior of your life, you can do that by just asking. So if you bow your heads, nobody looking around or getting up. If you want to ask Christ for your life, say something like this. Say, dear God, I know that you exist. I see it all around me. Today, Lord, I want to move from knowing you to trusting you. Today, God, I want you to come into my life, forgive me my sins, help me to trust you, help me to live for you. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. For some of you today, maybe you've already come to that point. Maybe you said, I already have a relationship with Christ. And my question, I guess, to you today is, are you making him known? You may know God, but are you making him known? Are you using your influence? Are you affecting your circle of friends and family and coworkers? Are you sharing the gospel with them, or are you silent? Are you afraid to speak up and talk about the faith that you have? And I just want to boldly challenge you. Let's be open about it. You know, the world tells us to be quiet. Don't talk. Keep your religion to yourself private. But that's not what the Lord wants from us. So I just want to challenge you, wherever you're at this morning, whatever the Lord takes you this week, just be yourself. Share the gospel. Share how God's changed your life and affected you. And maybe it will change somebody else's life as well. So this morning, the altar's open. If you want to come down and pray for something in your life that's going on, you're welcome to do that. If you want to come down and pray for your one, so that you'll have boldness and courage to be able to share. We'll have some staff and deacons down here. If you want to pray with them, you can do that. This morning, if you'd like to join the church and say, I feel like Westside is where I need to plant my life, my family, you're welcome to do that as well. This is the Lord's time. Whatever he's telling you, whatever he's speaking to you, maybe what JC said this morning about not knowing a follower has pricked your heart. And maybe there's something that you need to deal with through what she said. And then you need to go to the altar and you need to give something up to the Lord. Maybe there's a struggle that you have with a follower. I don't know. But whatever God's speaking to you, I pray that you listen and you move and you act. Let's pray. Dear God, we just come before you. Lord, this is your time. I've talked enough, but Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would convict and can comfort those in here this morning, God. You are God who exists, and you love us, and you want a relationship with us, God. Thank you for this time, Lord. May your Holy Spirit have free reign to speak to us this morning individually, and we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Overwhelmed.
God, we just come before your throne. Lord, I know people are still praying and still seeking you. And Lord, I just pray that they will continue to do that. They don't have to stop. Lord, thank you that you are a good God.
Amen.
That you are moved. You have moved in our presence this morning.
Amen.
Lord, I just pray that your word is gone out this morning. I pray that it will continue to marinate in our lives this week as we live out and walk out our faith in you, God. Lord, I pray that you'll comfort those who need comfort, and you'll convict us when we need to change. We need to do something right. Thank you for these decisions that were made this morning. And we love you, God. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat in just a minute. I'm going to ask my friends, Dave and Joanne, to come up here, if you will. I've known Dave, I guess, for about 7 years. Yeah, long time. But Dave has been a co-worker, a cohort in the Lord for many years. He served as the student pastor, assistant pastor at Bethany Church. And that's where I got to know you through the youth pastor meetings and all that. And you're an awesome man. And I know that because Joanne married you, she's awesome too. So,
she's more awesome.
They have been visiting with us for a couple weeks now, and one couple months now. But and I've just been pleased that you guys have jumped in. You are you're serving. You're already playing the priest man before you hit the camera. So I love that. But they're good folks, and I'm so glad that they're this morning. They're wishing to be a part of our church. But, all right, all those who would vote to have Joanne and Dave Wilson join us at Baptist Church, say aye.
Aye.
I don't need to post things on the well, thank you guys. What we want to do is just have you stand over here, and they will come down and give you a good handshake, fist bump, whatever you guys are comfortable with. You can do whatever hug or whatever you like to do. So, but just come down and greet them this morning. Just welcome you to Westside. And get to know them. They're good folks. I'm excited about that. If you are here this morning, we are currently giving our tithes and offerings, just putting it in the plate in the back there, so we won't pass the plate to you. But if you just want to drop anything in there on your way out, that'd be awesome. And the Lord is definitely blessing our church in that area, so we're thankful for that.
Amen.
And he's a good God. Amen. Tonight, we're going to go ministries at 6, so we got Justice Bob's table here tonight at 6 as well, so we hope you come back. And if not, we'll see you this Wednesday or next Sunday. Have a great day, and we'll see you later.